So let's get started. Our goal here is to explore some insights into a couple of things. So in recent decades, opposition to individual energy projects has blurred into opposition to the conventional regulatory frameworks within which these projects were discussed, including legal action against regulators. The frameworks themselves have become less efficient and their legitimacy has suffered. So we're going to explore why this has happened, to what extent the conventional regulatory model can be restored and strengthened versus finding new approaches to achieving social license. So Jatin, maybe we can start with you, and well, I'll get all the panelists to talk about this, but perhaps you could go first on the subject of this broader landscape and how we ended up here, how much bigger than the energy sector is this challenge, and what's going on out there.
Thank you, and thank you for coming. Let me begin not with an assertion, but perhaps a question, because if I began with an assertion, somebody might press the eject button on me. But let me ask, put it to you this way. Has the nuclear narrative really gone stale? Has its best before date passed? Or is there really a future for nuclear that has arrived? Perhaps in that context, I would like to elaborate on the issues around social values, and that may or may not play. By and large, the current storyline for nuclear is primarily a defensive posture, mired in what I call safety, waste, cost issues. Looking on as an outsider, the nuclear narrative seems entirely divorced from what I call the dominant social discourse of the day that drives the animated discussions around climate mitigation, the need for a low carbon energy future, scope and scale of change that revolutionary innovative technologies are about to bring upon us, and what role they may play in creating potential for very serious dislocation of the energy system as we know it, the centralized energy system. Often you hear, who needs nuclear? A loud refrain from several voices. What they say is, what we want are energy services, and these can be readily provided by smart distributed grids, connected homes and cars, enabled by energy storage that can become virtual power plants, introducing enormous flexibility into the system. Leave that aside for a moment. Let me suggest that the nuclear storyline, if it is to have any resonance in the broader public, will require a much sharper alignment of social values with a purpose. The nuclear narrative needs a major reboot, a refresh, and a serious rethinking on how to shape the dialogue on why nuclear matters and what can nuclear actually deliver on a global scale that is perhaps timely, meaningful, and that serves a social purpose. I want to touch upon, if you'll give me a minute or so, if that's okay.
Sure.
Why do values matter? And what can we learn from the climate change debate that has now been with us for almost a quarter of a century? So I believe there are these two dominant challenges that will be with us for the rest of this century. The one is really the question of climate change and getting to an energy transition that gets you to a low carbon future. That's not going to get away from us anytime soon. Climate science, I think, provides the solid foundational basis for that judgment. But we produce on a global scale a vast amount of energy. 15 terawatts, translate that into 500 plus exajoules of energy per year on a global scale. Vast proportion of energy generated that leaves a third of humanity in dark. So, what is the moral and ethical obligation that we collectively have to meet this challenge of a clean energy future and something that delivers energy to all the global citizens at some affordable price point, right? And if you then ask yourself the question of what is it about social values and the threat of climate change that came together? If you think about it, it was an alignment of social values in science, one. Took about 25 years, five major assessments of the IPCC that brought all the key global action actors to a point where we get the Paris Agreement. And you could argue that this was perhaps a triumph of diplomacy over discord. The key point that emerges out of 25 years of reflection on the climate change is that there was something that changed within the social temperament globally. And people began to say, there is an obligation beyond our current interest, that this is a change that's happening on a planetary scale. Carbon dioxide, by the way, is a harmless, odorless gas that doesn't do any harm at all whatsoever until you put it into the atmosphere and we know how that translates into. Rooted in this idea is this concern that intergenerational burden, intergenerational inequity, and something clicked. And what has happened now is that a very difficult issue has come together, marshaled actions, and countries are now committed to getting us to a low carbon energy future. So leaving the carbon question aside and how social values actually drove that debate to get us to where we did, I go on one more step further, that energy actually is the primary reason, driver, if you wish, of human betterment. So if we begin to frame and reframe the whole nuclear dialogue in terms of what is the purpose of that energy, that it is the betterment of the rest of mankind. Social values matter because they create the white space for the politicians to articulate why you would take action B versus A. So I'll finish by saying that alignment of the nuclear narrative with a, let's call it a higher and noble purpose, might actually reset the whole thing to someplace else, trying to convince somebody that we're safe and we're cost effective and we are environmentally good. May or may not get you there, but we need to frame it in something different. My opening remarks.
Okay, great. Monica, what do you think?
Something that I think is slightly different than what Jatin has just said, but probably quite complementary. So as you mentioned, Mark, at the outset, I chair a research project at the University of Ottawa called Positive Energy. It's a three-year project. We're in year two. We're actually just rounding off year two. And what this project seeks to do is try to strengthen public confidence in energy decision-making. Now, over the last number of years, notably the last decade, but you could go back even further, we've seen increasing levels of social opposition to energy development. Now, in the Canadian context, clearly hydrocarbons, notably the oil sands, and pipelines are really the flashpoints or the poster children, as it were, for social opposition. But it doesn't take that long to think through. This isn't just about hydrocarbons. Think about large-scale hydro. Folks in this room would obviously think about nuclear, think about wind in Ontario. You know, it doesn't take long to realize that there's levels of opposition to energy development across a whole host of energy sources. So we've been spending a good deal of our time trying to think through how can we accurately diagnose why we're facing this issue so that we can actually do something about it. And when it comes to diagnosing that issue, a good fundamental backdrop to that opposition are really transformed social values in the post-war period. And you asked, Mark, at the outset of your question, is this something that's exclusive to energy? It is absolutely not exclusive to energy. I was appointed director of the University of Ottawa's Institute for Science, Society, and Policy about a year and a half ago. So that is a really privileged perch because it gives me an opportunity to be involved in conversations across a host of different policy sectors. Energy is one, genomics is another, public health, science writ large. And in all of those conversations, there's a real concern about declining levels of public trust in public decision making. So if we look at the post-war period, there's been a very fundamental shift in social values. And I'm not going to have the time to go through all of this here, but I'm just going to point to three key changes that have really important implications for energy decision making, but also for a whole host of, I would argue, technology and science-based areas. The first of which is, if we look across all Western industrialized democracies, we see in the post-war period declining levels of trust in institutions, in industry, in government. Number two, we also see a decline of deference. Deference to expertise, deference to authority. People don't just accept the fact that their doctor says this is what's wrong with you, they start to become Dr. Google, right? So this is across all sectors of society. And at the same time, we're seeing people wanting to have greater levels of involvement in decisions that affect them, right? They want to be involved, they want to participate. So those three fundamental changes, and again, that's across all sectors. This is not exclusive to energy, but the impact is fundamental, particularly for technical, science-based, regulatory areas. Because what we find then is that there is greater levels of skepticism on the part of the public that government decisions are taken in ways that are balanced and that are legitimate. And if we look at our regulatory agencies, even if we look at broader policy making, those institutional actors in whom we see declining levels of trust, industry, government, experts, scientists, where do we find many of these? Well, in our regulatory processes. So folks are beginning to have less confidence in some of those processes. We're seeing less confidence as well in expertise and scientific evidence. One of the areas of expertise at the institute that I head is evidence-based decision making, and I could go on for hours about the amount of concern in the scientific community when it comes to evidence-based decision making or the lack thereof and the way in which we should try to think about how we can strengthen evidence-based decision making. Then the final impact I would point to is we're seeing increasing tensions between participatory democracy, right? People want to be involved in decisions that affect them, and representative democracy. At the end of the day, public authorities of one description or another need to take a decision, with a lot of tension in between those two, and folks increasingly being much more interested in the participatory side and really wanting to ensure that processes, decision-making processes, have legitimacy so that they can have confidence in the outcomes that come out the other side. And just to finish on this, and again, Mark, I think it's really important, this question you asked about, does this go beyond the energy sector? It absolutely does. We had the privilege at the Institute a few weeks ago of hosting Sir Peter Gluckman, who's the chief science advisor to the Prime Minister of New Zealand, and who is very much, for those who know this world, really a veritable dean of CSAs globally. And he came to the university, he gave a wonderful lecture that was very much focused on exactly this issue. And the title of his lecture was Science Advice in a Troubled World, and trying to think through how do we, if one wants to think of this term of post-truth politics, how do we, in the context, in that kind of a context, how do we make science advice stick? How do we do a better job of science advice? And for those who are potentially interested in this, the lecture and an interview with Sir Gluckman was broadcast last night on CBC's Ideas with Paul Kennedy. I know all of us were here, so of course we weren't listening to that, but I presume a podcast is available. It was an excellent, excellent lecture. But I'll stop there, and I think what's important, though, about your question, I'm really pleased that you've asked it, is that we're in a fundamentally different social and value context within which energy decision making is being undertaken. And many of our regulatory and decision making processes were actually built in that early post-war period and have not necessarily been updated to reflect this new reality. So I'm looking forward to getting into how we can do that with the remainder of this conversation.
Okay, great. Alan, is that consistent with what you've seen in other sectors? And I mentioned the broad range of areas that you've worked in, so.
Yeah, very much so. My background, since the early 90s, I've worked primarily in hard rock, but also around forestry and the hydrocarbons area, often representing indigenous groups or NGOs, but increasingly working with leaders inside the sector and financiers who are looking not to get trapped by the kind of conflict that people are experiencing across the broad range. So I kind of come at it from a slightly different angle, but my observations are entirely consistent with that. When I was first starting out in the early 90s, the level of access to information that people had and the level of connectivity between people in different regions, we were doing a bunch of work in the Andean region, for example, it was just, it's hard to imagine how small and how limited that was compared to the explosion of access to information and the instant connectivity that you have here. So that's one huge factor, is just that people have, for better or for worse, a lot more access to a lot more information. Whether it's accurate or not is another question, but they're also networked really, really effectively together. So the way in which activism unfolds is changed fundamentally, certainly in the time that I've been involved in it. But then with the evolution of the United Nations and the extent to which things like free, prior, and informed consent become hardwired into financial standards, World Bank standards, and other things like this, it's permeating throughout a system that echoes, I guess, another point that you were making, is that there is a broader sense that the decisions that are made that affect people directly will have to involve people. And been doing work, you know, with a range of banks and investors and others who are living this every day. And so that part of the participatory expectation is very much alive. And I often will say, the good news and the bad news is that in this environment, no one's driving the bus. You have to be prepared to put a hand on the steering wheel and a foot on the brake. Everyone, and the days of unilateralism are just gone. And that's not always a positive thing by any stretch of the imagination, but it can be a very, very good thing. There are good examples where the kind of engagement we're seeing, I think of the Voisey's Bay mine in Labrador, or some of the diamond mines we've got in the Northwest Territories, all established under largely extra regulatory agreements, hugely successful. Yes, they're complicated. Yes, they have their flaws, but they're hugely successful examples of intergenerational wealth transfer, a really advanced approach to environmental management, benefit sharing, and things like that. So it is possible, but there are also a lot of examples where the failure to engage that reality has led to the stalls that we see, whether it's on pipelines or major projects. There's a study that came out of University of Queensland, the Cost of Community Conflict. It's by Davis and Franks. It was published last year, a Harvard Kennedy School publication, and it estimates that on a for major projects, $3 to $5 billion projects in the extractives, you're looking at a net present value loss of about $20 million a week as a result of community conflicts. And this is just a widespread phenomenon, and there's more and more evidence gathered on that. You can argue about methodology on how you measure net present value and all that, but the key point is that this is a reality that's costing investors and developers billions on an annual basis, and it's a reality that, you know, a successful proponent really has to deal with. So it comes back to we've gone through a deregulatory period where we have lost a lot of confidence that either decisions will be made properly or, importantly, implementation will happen in a trustful way. We've seen a variety of splitting within the industry so that you've got very good and very bad actors, and people just don't know how to respond. And so industries like to look at their best actors and be judged by them, but the fact is you're going to be judged by your worst actors, and that lack of consistency across all projects and across all developers is something that you have to own. I know the hard rock industry has really struggled with that. So these are a variety of dynamics that have led to a degree of confusion, I think, in the political space, but also some real empowerment. And when it's taken seriously, and we'll talk later about risk and sharing and decision making that can engage people in a way that will considerably increase their willingness to take on risks. There are strategies that can happen that way, but you guys are clearly not alone in this, and this phenomena is only going to increase in terms of its impact on the ability to get any major projects developed.
Did you want to add something to that, Jatin?
I wanted to reflect upon this question of, so how do I find out what's true and whom do I trust in anchoring my judgment about something is true or not true? And I don't think that's, and we're inundated with information and trying to make sense out of all the disparate voices that are out there pushing things one way or the other. But how do I make sense out of my context and my life and what's important, what's true, and who can I trust? Well, it's always done in the context of your own life. Let's accept that. And I will link this to where nuclear really missed the path here in the following way. If you think about the enormous contribution of nuclear technology to effective mortality reduction on a global scale through use of medical isotopes and cobalt therapy treatment and what have you, it far overwhelms just about anything in terms of debates that you can have about whether nuclear power was 1 cent lower than something else, right? That has not been part of the narrative, that has been completely missed. But this is a science and a technology that has brought to the world an enormous amount of good, right? Completely missing. So all I'm trying to get at is, if you asked me, if I had been diagnosed with a particular cancer or an issue, my trust will immediately go to the physicians who are treating me. And if I had a perspective and a desire to know more as to what are the tools and methods and techniques that they are actually using to help me, it would become evident, be clear. So you cannot be dismissive of, you know, it's all somebody else's fact. It can be related to individuals, to communities, sure, in a way that is meaningful. So all I say is this question of trust, who do I trust, and it is important, and it's not only nuclear, but all industries face that. But there is a link here in terms of the industry perhaps trying to shape and build a narrative that's broader than what I call a defensive posture, which is just we're safe and we're low cost and we're good, you know.
So Monica, do we need to know and understand why this is happening? Why, in spite of the fact that you hear the term evidence-based thrown around a lot, that people in a lot of cases don't trust the evidence that they're hearing? Mm-hmm. And we've seen it in the whole vaccine discussion, for example. That's an example of it in terms of people's personal health and the decisions they make about their families. But I'm not sure that this is what people would have expected in an age where there's more information and more knowledge than ever before, right?
Yeah. Well, what we've done in the research that we've undertaken is taken a very applied approach. So sort of rather than philosophize and sort of fall in love with the problem, let's actually look at how this is playing out for, you know, in real energy decision-making processes. So recently, just last fall, we released a very substantial, comprehensive study that looked at a number of energy project decision-making processes. We were focused just at the project level, half a dozen projects across the country, variety of different energy projects. Unfortunately, nuclear was not one of them, but everything from pipelines to electricity transmission lines to shale gas to gas plants to, you know, again, across the country, to really try to get a better understanding of what are the drivers of local community levels of satisfaction with energy project decision-making processes and trust in energy project decision-making processes. And we actually called the final report a matter of trust, because so much of what came out of that research, and we were very careful when it came to selecting the projects that we were going to be focusing on to include some that were very clearly very contentious, highly opposed by communities, and include others where, to Alan's point, where there were forms of decision-making, forms of approaching the project that actually led to very high levels of satisfaction and trust in the process. And so a number of things, you know, came out of that. I don't think there's any one thing that you can point to. That, for us, is a really key message, is that there's no silver bullet for addressing these issues. These issues need to be addressed at a number of different levels, right? So when it comes to thinking through project approval process or decision-making processes with respect to projects, there's often a sort of a reflex on the part of industry or on the part of proponents, well, if only the community understood the project, they would support the project. And it came through very clearly in our research that, you know, yes, literacy is important and access to information that is credible and reliable is important, but information is not all that's important. In many instances, what came through very clearly was sometimes a mismatch between community values and the kind of project that was being proposed. And so context is so extremely important, to Jatin's point, to think that, you know, energy technology A could be proposed in communities X, Y, Z, D, E, F, all in the same way and be received in the same way. Our research really suggests that that's not the case, that context matters, that thinking through what the community values are, what their history has been with previous large-scale industry projects, notably, and thinking through where their trust comes from when it comes to information. So I'll give you a concrete example on this, and then we can move on. But one of the projects that we explored was the Wasquatum Hydroelectricity Project in northern Manitoba, which is a joint project between Manitoba Hydro and a Cree First Nation in northern Manitoba. And to get around this issue of trust in evidence, rather than have Manitoba Hydro and the community each do their own environmental impact assessment, they actually did a joint environmental impact assessment. They, you know, jointly decided which firm is going to be undertaking this, what will the scope of that project be, so that when they came before the regulatory board, they actually were not fighting about the evidence. They actually had shared evidence. So one of the things for us that's really coming through is the importance of process and the importance of thinking through how can we do a better job of co-producing evidence so that those who are in these processes can have greater faith and confidence in that evidence, because it's not being sort of provided to them by somebody else. They're actually involved in the development of that evidence as well. So it really puts some of our thinking on its head in terms of how do we go about developing evidence when it comes to taking energy decisions.
All right, Alan, what do you think in terms of what the energy sector can do to overcome this challenge?
Well, we've seen, the arguments that have been put forward so far really highlight the fact that there is no ability to just explain yourself and be accepted, and that the context of any one community and its decision making structures, its willingness to take on risks, its willingness to share in benefits. I mean, these things are all real, and I think are part of a somewhat reluctantly embraced best practice I've seen in a few different areas. And so I think that's kind of the starting point, because as you were saying, it's an understandable impulse to say, well, if you just understood how much we know about this industry and how good it is, you would embrace it, but you're clearly just not paying enough attention. And often the community will, if you just really understood how good our community is and how we make decisions and how we define safety for our most vulnerable people, then you would think really differently about how you even set foot in this community. We hear that discussion a lot, right? But the good news, I think, is that, I don't have to tell you guys this, but the reality of a low frequency or low likelihood, high consequence failure is something that is your burden. But it's also, if you look at the hard rock mining area, the tailings dam safety issue is kind of their meltdown situation. And we've seen in Brazil with the San Marcos spill, where 19 people died and thousands of hectares of land were contaminated. We've seen in British Columbia, where a major tailings dam was the largest tailings failure, billions of liters of liquid spilled out. Those things are real and they're immediate and they're happening within circumstances that people were told they shouldn't happen in. That's a real problem. So you've got to deal with that question of, these aren't imagined risks, these are real for these people and they read a lot about them. But I guess the flip side to that is that my experience is that people are not, communities are not necessarily risk averse, but they will only accept risk commensurate to the degree to which, as you say, they can co-define that, what it is, how risk is understood to them economically, socially, culturally. When that dialogue starts to be a real dialogue on how you get to an understanding of risks and how that is defined through a community lens, then you sort of move to another level of saying, well, okay, under this light, mitigation looks like this, and here's the contingency plan and the contingency plan for the contingency plan, and then you walk through that, and then you work together on your mitigation, and then finally there's the question of benefits, and what do we get other than a broad social good? A broad social good will not get you a cup of coffee in most communities, unfortunately. I shouldn't say that, because people are constantly investing in the wealth of the community, but if an outsider comes and says, this is great for the planet, you're not likely to get very far. So I think it's, what are the particular and concrete benefits? How can we adapt the evolving economy to advance community interests? Again, I go back to things like Voisey's Bay and others. And just as a little aside, it's a fascinating case study, because originally that mine, which is the second largest nickel deposit ever found in the world, was to be a 7-year high intensity throughput mine. And there's lots that's really interesting about the way the agreement came to be, but in the end it was a 27-year mine. Why? Because the community knew that all the benefits, even if they were thrown at them within a 7-year period, would just blow them out completely. And it was a question of pace and scale that was matched to what that generation could do in that area with that resource. And it's a really interesting example of listening carefully and ending up with a successful project as a result, completely against what the original plan was. And I'm sure there are many finance people that lost their minds around this stuff. But it turns out it's a successful project, and it's a stable environment in which we can now reference for other projects. So.
We're going to open it up to your questions in a moment, so be ready for that. If you have a comment you want to make, if you want to join the discussion, we'll get a microphone to you. But Jatin and Monica, maybe you can add to what Alan has been saying. Are there other thoughts you have specifically about the nuclear sector? And I know there are probably people here who feel like this issue we're describing is one the nuclear sector has dealt with for a long time, this kind of misconception about how safe it is, how clean it is. So this is a familiar problem to a lot of people in the industry, I think.
Let me raise 2 points, and in fact complement what Monica and Alan have said. And I'd like to use 2 words, which is what I call co-development or co-sharing of the base of information around which you come to a conclusion on whether something is good or no good. And for a very long time in this industry, if my memory serves me right, we use the word educate them, right? Like, we have the facts. We know what it is all about, and you don't. So I'm going to educate you. Highly paternalistic, got nowhere, and in fact, it just gets your back up. So much to learn here from what social anthropologists can teach us about how people evaluate information and make judgments about what they think their expectation and good outcome from any particular situation is, and so I call it partnerships, co-development, and co-sharing of information base, as Alan said, developed to a notion which says, okay, I think there's something in this for us. And let me cite another positive example. I don't know all the details at this stage, but the Canadian Nuclear Fuel Waste Management Program, waste is an interminable, difficult issue, contentious, as you know. But over the last seems like a decade, the work that they have done around adaptive phase management, the involvement of communities, taking practically a leaf out of our First Nations community and saying, you know, intergenerational burden, what do you mean? How long? They say, in First Nations community, seven generations is about what they think in terms of looking ahead. So that became part of a semi-quantitative criteria, if you wish, in the way they are designing their options and plans and so on. But all that came and emerged out of deep discussions within the NWMO folks and others, and it's all there in their reports. But so that's a positive example. That says, you know, we're not just simply going to say, we know how to dig a hole, we're going to put this in a copper container, it won't corrode, and here is our probabilistic assessment that tells you this will be just fine. No, that won't get you anywhere, but it's that. Okay, so that's
what. Okay, great. Monica?
Yeah, I just add a few points to that, and you stole my NWMO example. so I'll go in a different direction. But you know, if I'm hearing in your question, Mark, you're thinking too about kind of the history of nuclear. And if you look at, you know, in the social sciences literature around analyses of risk, and you know, Ulrich Beck and the Risk Society, and you know, Mary Douglas and Wildavsky, all the work that they did around kind of transformation in American values and sort of almost the development of anti-technology values. And this goes back decades. And nuclear is often an example that's actually addressed quite frontally in that work, and is addressed and critiqued in many instances from precisely the perspective that Jatin just mentioned, which is sort of that you know, what could be framed or is often framed as the, you know, the knowledge deficit model or the science deficit model, where it's a matter of education. And I think we're in a different phase now. And I also have seen, not only in nuclear, because I know a number of folks in this room who are very keenly interested in addressing these issues, but across other energy subsectors as well, a real, I think, awakening to that's not working anymore. We need to think about how we can do things differently. And we're beginning to see many companies, proponents that are moving in that direction. And one of the things that's come out of in our work, and I think is going to be key potentially for nuclear, depending on which technology you're talking about, is, you know, how do we build how do we shift from thinking about very polarized ways of thinking about community involvement in energy decision making. So whether those communities are municipalities or indigenous communities, you know, that it's often a very polarizing or polarized way of thinking about their involvement. You know, do they have a veto? Right, that's not a terribly helpful way of thinking about the issue, and I think we need to think about how can we shift from that kind of way of thinking, from vetoes to actually bridges. How do we build bridges with communities? Because many energy projects, and nuclear, large-scale nuclear would fit into that basket, are really about energy services for broader than community needs. And as Alan mentioned, and I couldn't agree more, walking into a community and saying this is really good for the national interest is not going to get you so far. That would be another value change that you could easily point to, which is sort of that the community or group level values. We've moved much more towards a greater focus on individual interests and values. And in that context, appeals to the regional or provincial or national interests are getting less traction. Communities, to your point, Alan, really want to look at, well, you know, what does this mean for us? And so how do we build a bridge between larger scale energy projects, nuclear would fit into that basket, and local community interests and needs? And what are some of those bridges? I mean, we're working on that right now at Positive Energy. Alan's mentioned a number of examples. Sometimes those bridges are financial. Sometimes those bridges are relating to values and framing things up in a way that aligns better with community values and the interests of that community in its own development. But I think we also, and this is where the NWMO is very interesting, we also need to be very open to the possibility that the answer could be no. The answer could be we don't go forward with this project. And one of the things that we evacuated from our vocabulary very early on in our research, in the energy sector, it is so common when you're talking about projects to talk about project approval processes. You go into a community and you say, we're in the midst of a project approval process, somebody listens to that and they think, well, the fix is in. This is happening. Why are they even talking to me? So we don't use that language at all anymore. We talk about energy project decision-making processes. And you know, we know this stuff. There's so much literature around engagement has to be real and early and meaningful. And that means that there have to be potentially real changes to a project that are possible, including saying no.
Jatin?
If I may, since Monica started the history question, go back to the origin of the industry and its source. And I may have made my same point earlier in my remarks, but the enabling vision at that time, this is going back into the 1950s, Eisenhower, peaceful atoms for peaceful uses of atom, the whole narrative around swords into plowshares following the war, abundance of energy for development. There was something that someone could get charged up about. In the passage of time, nuclear kind of matured, lost its way, got ossified into what I call operational mode of thinking about today-to-day challenges and so on. And that's fair enough. Every CEO, of course, needs to be razor sharp about challenges ahead, knowing exactly where he came from, but the blind spots on nuclear are not being properly taken care of. And those blind spots are really the social dynamics and values that determine what's the context it is that you're trying to give me this solution that makes any sense to me. And that's where we've lost, and that's perhaps where we may begin to rephrase the nuclear option as something larger than life.
Okay. I think we have a question over here. Yep.
Hi there. Thank you very much. My name is Ingrid Thompson. I'm with Pollution Probe, which is, for those who don't know us, what you would call a pragmatic environmental energy engaged organization. I'm curious, having spent a good chunk of the last decade living abroad, whether there has been any research into what I perceive maybe incorrectly to be a slight difference in how a number of European countries seem to be having traction on getting their, I'll say, infrastructure projects, not specific to energy. But for example, I lived in Holland. Some of the best infrastructure projects I've seen, you know, that seem to go out very easily around you in the context of a very sort of socially engaged culture, which has strong environmental values. And yet, it somehow seems to arrive at decisions. And you're right, some of them are no, which I will acknowledge. I'm just wondering if there's any thought or has anyone looked at, why does it seem harder here? Or does it just seem that way and we aren't actually perceiving correctly?
Okay, Jatin?
I have a wonderful example that is actually true too.
So this is evidence-based.
It's evidence-based. Yeah. Let's look at the UK. 2003, some select committee of the House of Commons or Lords or something did a report on you know, energy futures for the UK as climate change began to develop as an issue. And not a word you could find in that report. This is 2003, word nuclear. You know, page 77 maybe is a footnote somewhere. Year 2009 was a complete reversal in the UK around the question of nuclear, 2008-2009, in terms of the next set of white papers and one or two change of prime minister and so on, and the British are back on with respect to complete commitment to nuclear, and that has now stuck. And with issues around cost challenges, that's a different discussion. How did that happen is the question you're asking, you know, in a country like the UK, and we've got similar governance structures and so on. Well, as Sir David King explained this, so I'm actually paraphrasing him, what they did were two or three things, actually. One was getting into the high school system. Get the teachers factory based and found a way to bring the whole nuclear story in understandable terms in terms of both the physics of it and potential benefit to society and so on. So there was, and it became very fashionable in high school cafeterias to call them fish and chips. Fission, F-I-S-S-I-O-N, chips, right? So that So it's getting at a certain nascent cultural level into the system. Number two, they also, journalists was another. So I don't think we in Canada really go that deep into working with our journalists around the nuclear story, let's call it. And they did that in a very determined way, and so the dynamics of the debates began to shift. There's still anti-nuclear people in the UK, we know that. And number three, which I thought was really quite interesting, was, as you know, governments come and go, so you're opposition right now and you're government today. If you're government, you have access to all the expertise, the information, and so on, and you make your decisions. If you're in the opposition, you're kind of scrambling for any tidbits of information that can come from anywhere to just shame the government into whatever. Well, as they developed their narrative, they developed white papers and expert studies and so on, and were fed to the opposition as well, and they became part of the understanding of where they were going. So as the governments change, the next set of guys come up and they say, this is just the policy, perfect for us. We were opposing it, now we're back in. That happened with the Labour government and the Conservative government when that shift occurred. So it was to bring along the legislators on the trip so that the monopoly of the information and expert advice is not just dominated by flow into the government of the day, but that the opposition also has access to it. So this is explained by Sir David King, was, I thought, a rather interesting way to go from nuclear no to nuclear is part of the UK energy mix, and they made commitments to do so.
Okay. We have a question here and then another one over there. So let's, and then one here too. Okay. Get to as many of these as we can. Go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on a remark that Monica made in her statement. I did listen to the interview last night with Sir Peter Gluckman. He raised, I think, an important, very important point, and that is the nature of how decisions are made. I think as engineers, most of us have the sense that if the technology evaluation supports a particular decision, that's the decision that should be made. And in fact, that's not how decisions are typically made now. The policy, the science support has to be there, but it's only one input to the decision-making process. And while we have to have that to support a decision, it doesn't mean that that particular decision will be made. There are many other factors that come into the process.
Okay. I believe there was a question there in the second row of that section.
Hi, Dr. Gattinger. You mentioned that there's kind of a lack of trust and expertise, and I assume this is more specifically in developed countries like Canada. But have you looked into the lack of expertise possibly in developing countries? Like, for example, in China. Like, how does it compare to Canada?
And I was actually going to comment on the question that came forward from the woman from Pollution Probe, which was a really good question. So in our research, we haven't actually looked comparatively, not with other OECD countries. That's, you know, talk to me in a year and we can have this conversation. And we have not looked at China specifically either. But one of the things that I did want to point to, if I could just quickly come back to the Pollution Probe question, is that I think there are, in the Canadian context, we've talked about social and value change. And my apologies that I can't directly speak to that question. Maybe somebody else on the panel can. So we've talked about social and value change. We've talked about project decision-making processes. We haven't talked about policy. And in the Canadian context, I think that's one major factor that has actually led to some stumbling blocks when it comes to the approval of individual projects in energy. So we, in our research, have identified a number of different gaps in policy. We actually talked at one point about, you know, we should have t-shirts made up that say, ask me about my policy gaps. Because there are three key areas where, until recently, governments have not perhaps been as active as they could have been. Climate would be one. Second would be reconciliation. This is huge. In the Canadian context, no single project can resolve issues around reconciliation or address the process of reconciliation in a comprehensive way. But in the absence of policy action at that broader level, again, until recently, and we'll see where all of that goes, but in the absence of greater action at that broader level, we've seen a lot of opposition actually playing itself out in individual energy project decision-making processes in the regulatory arena, when really those are policy questions. And then the third gap, if I was wearing that t-shirt, I'd say, okay, gap number three, relates to cumulative effects and regional effects management. So in many instances, the opposition is not about that particular project per se, it's about what about the one over there and the one that comes after that and all of the cumulative effects of these projects. And yet in the Canadian context, we have relatively modest, if any at all, regional planning processes, strategic environmental assessments. You know, there's a gap there that our research is suggesting is also helping to explain why we're seeing some of these challenges in terms of public confidence. It was. It absolutely was. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But in fairness, it's really hard stuff to do. But to Alan's point, I think, there are costs to not doing things differently. I mean, we often talk in our work, tongue in cheek about make haste, but slowly, like informed reform of our decision-making processes. Let's be, accurately diagnose what the problems are and then work on resolving them in a way that will actually have a sustainable change and a change that will actually be enduring and effective.
Yeah. Alan, did you want to make a quick comment before we
go
to
the next question? China and developing world questions, I've had, through this work I'm doing on mining standards, I'm working with groups like Tiffany's and Anglo American and ArcelorMittal, and as well as Oxfam and others. So we've been traveling a bit to see that, and so I was in Beijing, and I just came back from Cape Town. So I've had a chance to talk to people about how they might use extra regulatory processes like certification to fill their trust gap, and these are very real. I mean, in China, they're trying to develop new standards that could be used and understood both domestically and otherwise, and of course there's a lot of challenges around that, but it's the absence of solving that problem is major political instability and others, and then certainly in Africa the lack of confidence in public institutions would be is so profound that interestingly enough it's put new pressure on companies and also requiring a level of sophistication in civil society that is probably higher than we're getting here. It was also my experience in Latin America in the 90s, is that incredibly sophisticated responses that are coming out as a result of the absence of confidence in government. So I've always been I come back humbled by those experiences, partly because they have a very elevated sense of how good our governance institutions are, and I have to disabuse them of that. And then also just to realize just how advanced a lot of the thinking is on how they can internalize their own risk management problems. So I think that there are a lot more similarities than we anticipate, and a lot of the problems are commonly shared.
Okay, we have a question at the back here. Go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon, panelists. Thank you very much for your insight. My name is Ross Holden. I'm with the Nuclear Waste Management Organization's Aboriginal Relations Group. So I also appreciate your nod to our process. I would perhaps like to offer a little bit more insight into our approach, maybe dig a bit deeper. Sure, we have the time. We have lots of time. It's a long-term project. We are able to provide information to people, we are able to take the time, and yes, sometimes the word educate gets used, and it is an inappropriate word, but as you probably know, and as other people in the room probably know, a common refrain, or what we commonly hear, especially working with Indigenous communities, is that it's all about trust, and this gets back to a point made earlier about an increasing lack of trust in institutions, in government, in science. So it's all about trust. Why should we trust you? Our response to that is increasingly, don't trust us. Trust yourself. Take the time to learn, as much time as you need, to learn about the project, the science behind it, the regulatory processes, the industry, and trust yourself. Often we're working in communities where the highest level education on average might be grade 11 or 12. People haven't taken a science course since grade 6. They don't know anything about radiation. They don't know how a nuclear reactor works. They don't know that there's a regulator sometimes. So we take, whether it's 2 or 3 years, we take the time to provide whatever information we can, and then we actively encourage them to look at outside sources, contradictory sources, whatever it takes, and they take the time to learn. And it's actually quite astounding, I find, we found, once people have learned for themselves, they gain that confidence and they trust themselves to have an opinion, to have an informed opinion about the project. And you're right, we have to always say it's a qualifier, this project may not go ahead. And that is incredibly powerful as well, we found. So I just wanted to pass that on. We find that when people take the time to learn in depth, they trust themselves, and that makes all the difference in our experience. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to take maybe two more questions. We've got one here in the front, so we'll get you a microphone in a sec, but go ahead, Ron.
Am I going first because I got the mic? All right, I'll go first. Ron Oberth, OCNI, and I know Jatin and Monica. I just want to commend the panel on how articulately you're expressing your views. But I have a sort of a high school exam question, compare and contrast. How many times have we heard that? Since we've talked about Europe, I'd like the panel to compare and contrast decision-making with respect to energy in the UK and Germany. Two countries which have similar cultures, similar rational approaches to thinking and decision-making, and yet one is going to adopt, or is adopting, a totally renewables path and a different future from the UK, which believes strongly that nuclear is a major part of its energy future. How would you explain those two radically different outcomes with the same set of facts?
Who wants to go first? Alan?
It's actually not a topic that I'm qualified to speak on. I'm not that familiar with the specifics of the energy policy in those two countries. I can speak more broadly about the government institutions and the confidence in rule of law and the ability of institutions to follow through and regulate in a consistent manner. That is an area that I think is a major difference between the European community and ours. But when it comes to intergovernmental or international aspects, I'll defer to my colleagues.
Well, now we'll defer to my colleague here. But what I would say, though, lots of deference going. See, we still defer up here. We're still deferent. what I would note, though, is, you know, there's a lot of fascinating research in social science around what's referred to in academic terms as motivated reasoning, which in essence means that when it comes to the evidence that people have confidence in, that is not necessarily a rational, comprehensive, technical process, that it is informed by people's values and worldviews, right? And so to Jatin's point earlier about, you know, building the case for nuclear or rebranding nuclear, however you want to think of that, that framing that in a way that aligns with values. I mean, in that literature, folks often talk about you've got two channels when you're communicating with folks about information and evidence, one of which is the content channel, the sort of, you know, science deficit model, educational model we've been talking about. The other channel, though, is the values channel, and ensuring that, you know, there is an alignment between the values of the individual and their worldview and the evidence that's being presented to them. And so I don't know the answer to your question, but one hypothesis would be that different values will see different countries, different communities, different whatever the unit of analysis is, taking different decisions on seemingly the same evidence. And I think that's something we all need to be really quite conscious of in terms of the role, and that's what this panel is about, the role of values in decision making.
If
If I may briefly reflect upon Ron's question, I did spend a year in Germany just a couple of years ago on a sabbatical, and at Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, Center of Nuclear Research in Germany, and I wasn't doing nuclear research. The German question is an imponderable one, in a very difficult one, and Monica says there is a deep undercurrent of a concern around nuclear in ways that's almost impenetrable now to be able to decipher in any rational economic discussion. The Energiewende that has come up, that got speeded up, let's call it post-Fukushima, and then cast into law, and then they're on a path to shutting down the nuclear power plants. There are fractures emerging a decade and a half later to say, well, is this really right, and are we going to be able to do it? And so it's an unfinished story, let's call it. But the reason they got to where they got to is very deeply social and cultural attributes of how they thought about things. And there's nothing you can say today in terms of your carbon emissions are going high because of your renewables, and although you want carbon, they're burning more coal and so on. That will not reverse their nuclear at this stage. It's just an imponderable, in my view.
Proximity to Chernobyl, does it come down to something as simple and traumatic as that? I mean, of course, it's never simple, but the proximity there.
Yeah, the puzzle is, you know, the accident happens in Fukushima and you shut down reactors in Germany, which are the safest reactors, and you say to yourself, help me understand. But it is a deeper social and cultural issue that.
Okay, last question will be right here.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the talk. I have a two-part question, and it's open to anybody who can answer it. First, it's to what extent can investment in and advocacy for nuclear weapons, non-proliferation, and disarmament help improve the image of the nuclear energy industry? And secondly, what role can the new generation play in increasing the contribution of science and evidence in public decision-making processes? What role can the new generation play in...
Like young people?
Yeah, okay, like millennials.
Okay. You know? I'm thinking electricity generation.
Right. thinking new generation concepts, but...
Yeah. It's open to anybody. Yeah. Thank you.
All right, well, just because we're short on time, maybe get a quick answer from each of you on that. Alan?
I think that when you disentangle, it is really important to disentangle which threats are and which concerns are associated with people's opposition. So I wouldn't for a moment underestimate the fact that a clear position related to the use of nuclear technology as a military force would be something that would be a prerequisite almost for even the beginning of certain signs of certain kinds of conversations. So I think that's unpacking that, not making assumptions about it would be really, really important, and being clear about, as clear as you can be in that, is going to be important in assuaging some of the fears. And I think there is, it's remarkable how history-free the new generation is and how unburdened they are by history. As at least my experience, I've been teaching in some business schools recently, and it's just, oh, okay, we got a fresh start here. That's the good news. It's also a little bit the bad news. So I do believe that the imperative around clean technology, which will be a materials intensive, whether we like it or not, is a really compelling one. And that if you do take that out of fresh start, and you build that into the suite of things that we need to do as a society to pull this off, I'm optimistic that you can have a different kind of conversation that's not as mired in some of the historical assumptions that are there. It's not that the issues will go away, but they'll be able to be reframed. So I think they're definitely a rich mine to be tapped into.
Yeah, and I'll pick up on the second part of the question because I know time is short. I'm really optimistic, actually, about you people. And there's a number of reasons, one of which is what I see in our students, graduate students, and I had an institute that is cross-faculty, right? So I got an opportunity to meet students from across university, engineering, science, law, business, social science, I mean, you name it, arts. And so many of them, they're not silo disciplinary focused, they're problem focused, right? And they want to meet other people who are addressing other parts of their problem, but from a different disciplinary perspective. So some of the most amazing student events and interactions that we have are between students across different faculties. We have a master's program, a collaborative master's program, where somebody who's in engineering can come into contact with somebody who's in graduate students in a variety of other different faculties and disciplines and learn about the science-society policy interface. And you know, that to me is extremely hopeful because I think that's part of what has gotten us into some of these challenges is those disciplinary silos. And if you only understood me, and on the other side, the folks are saying, well, if you only understood me. But I see a real sort of a reflex in the younger generation to try to cross those bridges and to be wanting to cross those bridges. I see that as extremely, extremely positive and optimistic for me.
I'll just build on that last point and conclude given time. The universities have been culprits in the sense that, you know, over the last two centuries or so, this silos and development of deep expertise, of course, necessary. But where we need to move to is what I call knowledge integration initiatives or centers is what we call them. And this is deep integration of knowledge across domains to deal with complex problems and issues that we face in society, whether it's untangling the whole nuclear proliferation or next generation nuclear concepts which are proliferation resistant, to dealing with climate change questions, are all complex questions. In my view, ain't going to do the trick. It will have to be. But how do you engender that right at the get-go in the learning curriculum and processes and not, by the way, at the end of it stapled together six things. So I think that's where I remain hopeful. And I'll answer one last question that was raised by one of the gentlemen back there about experts and role of experts in decision making and so on. And it's a wonderful apt quote by none other than Mr. Churchill, who says, you know, we need experts on tap, but we don't need them on top.
Okay, thank you for those great questions and comments, and a big thank you to our panel, Alan, Monica, Jatin.